into graffiti land. All the rides are in your head. The ticket is what is thought and what is said. Our attitudes are climbing. We don't have time for more mind-wasting lies. Whatever it is you're doing, we're not going to buy it. It's time to say something, not a time to be quiet. Rant and roll, hearts beat from the spirit. Say it loud so everyone can hear it. Say what you mean what you say. Rant and roll when you feel that way. Religions of men, heavy with fear. Industrial war against the land. Every woman knows the fugitive. Rich men keep living off the poor. The soul is what's left after they eat your spirit. When every act is an act of self-defense, it's time to do something or perish in the pretense. Rant and roll, heart speak from the spirit. Say it loud so everyone can hear it. Say what you mean what you say. Rant and roll when you feel that way.
Hello everyone and welcome. It's 2000 BC. Today is Thursday, the 18th of December, 1997. We are gathered with some friends to welcome our friends from South Dakota, Tom and his wife Loretta. This evening, we're going to talk about the potential of growing industrial hemp within the United States of America. This is just recording, and we're going to play this for KPFK Radio, and we're going to send this back to South Dakota to play on Keeley Radio, the voice of the Lakota Nation. Okay, so Tom Cook has been involved for years. He's from the East Coast. He's a Mohawk and came out and met his wife in South Dakota in the early 70s. I aged him by 3 years earlier today, sending out a press release saying he was 52. He's only 49 years old. So we're really glad to welcome him. Tom's been organizing for years in South Dakota and around the country. And one of the things he's brought was community gardens so that old people could get food inexpensively or free and tried to do that in different areas. And after realizing how important hemp was to the future of the people there and to the future of the planet, he dedicated himself to working towards bringing hemp to the Lakota Nation. And this is Tom Cook. Please give me your attention.
Thank you, Craig. My name is Tom Cook. Ganatakunoyate is my name in Indian, in Mohawk. I'm from the Akwesasne Reservation in northern New York State, Canada. I grew up on a dairy farm on State Road District of Akwesasne, and from age 11 got to run tractors. Since 1985, my wife and I started Slim Buttes AgriDev. We started a family-based community effort to help people grow vegetables on Pine Ridge. We got a $500 grant from the farm in Tennessee, with which we helped put six gardens in 1985. From that period, year to year, we doubled the amount of program participants, and last year had 144 gardens on Pine Ridge Reservation. We have been operating as a program of Running Strong for American Indian Youth for 4 or 5 years now. We are satisfied that in 12 years of program development, we have the capacity to assist 200, as many as 300 vegetable gardens on Pine Ridge Reservation. We operate 5 tractors and have worked with several, 6, 7 other gardening programs on Pine Ridge ever since the 80s. Back several years ago, my brother-in-law, he told me, he said, you're growing for 25 cents a cucumber, pound of cucumbers, you're growing the wrong crop. You could get $2,500 a pound, he said, from the stuff I got. And from that, I listen for input among the growing numbers of families we work with. And I can say that there are interested, vitally interested people on Pine Ridge wanting to use their own land for their own benefit. They struggle to maintain vegetable gardens year to year, and some do in better jobs by the year as their families take care of the garden. We help them get started. We responded to requests in our community, which is in the southwesternmost of Pine Ridge Reservation, to stand up the Land Use Association again. LUA operated as a owner-owned co-op from 1938 until the early 50s, when BIA land operations shut them down. And since that time, they had no accounting from their Kansas City LUA account. I tracked that co-op, the 9-11 others that were put forth, funded by the federal government to bring the people into the Indian Reorganization Act. And when the act was accepted by the people, these LUAs lasted for a quarter century, and then they were shut down by the BIA. So in an effort to respond to these requests, we undertook the development of the same LUA, the same dozen guys that owned blocks of property, combined it together, and they had an 8,000 acre range unit and ran 2,000 head of cows for a couple decades. My wife's grandfather was one of the charter members. That's me. The present Land Use Association met and was formed at the Long Visitor home site on the White River and Slim Buttes community, and it elected officers and set a program for 1998 development. We have a resolution, we have resolutions of support from every level of community, district, committee, governments, and we have clearance on to proceed with ordinances, statutes, that will be presented in January session of the Oglala Sioux Tribal Council. This ordinance for hemp production will be limited to, as far as we're concerned, to land use associations throughout the reservation, so that we can keep the base of impact of this production to the landowners that live in the creek and bottom lands of this 5,000 square mile territory and be of benefit to them, the landowners. We're putting forth the same LUA that there was in the 30s. If it was a good idea then, it's a good idea now, and for the same purposes. We're confident of capacity for a co-op to do It's land. It's production, the input requirements. But we face the question of support to the hemp proposition. The LUA members want to, those that are involved in the hemp program want to plant in the spring of 98. And depend upon the ordinance at the Oglala Sioux tribe to proceed on. But we face a large, important problem, fight, struggle with the distinctions of the hemp industrial plant and the narcotic marijuana. And for those insights and perspectives, I'm going to depend upon my co-law, John Trudell, whom I've known since the 60s, to help me and us and Joe American Horse as program manager of the LUA to put forth and adequately address and do justice to these definitions.
Does this thing work?
It doesn't amplify.
All right, too bad it's recording. All right.
Loud?
All right, well, I'm going to try to be coherent. But I have my own feelings and attitudes. I mean, I'll start like this. I look at hemp as medicine. Now, especially like in California, people are aware of medical usage of marijuana as a medicine in the terms of marijuana as a medicine in relationship to human consumption or human usage. But when you look at hemp, just hemp in general, hemp is a medicine for the earth. It is the earth's medicine. Because where the hemp grows, it's healthy for the earth. Where the hemp grows, you can take the hemp and you can make fuel, you can make clothes, you can make food. You can make basically just about anything out of hemp. So it isn't like destroying the forest or having to pollute the air with a petrochemical society. So when I look at it, hemp truly is a medicine for the earth. This goes way beyond just hemp as a medicine, goes way beyond our human interpretation of marijuana as a medicinal usage. Hemp is truly medicine. And when we look at what is happening to the environment of the planet today, the earth needs all the medicine that she can get. I mean, we can talk about legislative laws, we can talk about making something legal or illegal, we have to deal with these terms. But to me, I get right down to just the basic reality of it, is the earth needs her medicine. Because technologic, religious civilization has plundered and abused the earth to such a degree that humankind's ability to live with the earth is becoming jeopardized. Now, and I say it like this because one thing is like, because I do not think that man can destroy the earth. I don't think man has that kind of power. That's a power way beyond man's reach to destroy the earth. But man can destroy man's ability to live with the earth. And that's what man can do. Now, but for us as human beings, because we're a part of this humankind, for us as human beings, we need to find a way to make medicine for the earth to stand against what has been done. And then for us as native people, you know, it's our land. And whatever it takes for us to live in harmony with our land, and living in harmony with our land means living in harmony with the earth, not poisoning the earth, but it also means not living in poverty and destitution and racial genocide programs that are directed against us because of a race or a culture or a class. Living in harmony with the land means living in harmony with the land. And so for us as human beings, native people, the people that understand to go to hemp and use hemp as a way of making a medicine for the earth and also making some kind of an economic base for the people, the children of the earth. This only makes sense to me. This is reasonable. It makes sense. Although we are in a situation where maybe basically the society just really doesn't see clearly anymore, doesn't understand clearly. The way the earth has been attacked and the way the environment has been polluted, the way all of these things are happening, It's almost as though it affects the sensibilities of the human beings. And I think that for us as people, it is time for us to start doing what is the most practical thing, what is the most realistic thing that is going to perpetuate life. Because life is about appreciation, participation, and perpetuation. That's what life is about, and to be lived. So those are the four things of life. And I think it's time for us to understand to get back to that way. And if one of the components of going in that direction is to grow hemp where the people are willing to grow hemp, where the people have that understanding of the role that hemp plays in the real world, then so be it. Then that's the way the people should be allowed to do these kinds of things. The right of the people to be allowed, the right of the people to do these kinds of things must be respected. It's not about allowing, it's about respecting. The right of the people to live as human beings must be respected. The right of the earth to live as the mother entity must be respected. Because a great deal of the things that are happening to us, you know, it's got to do with this Father God's removed off in heavens, and it's got to do with attacking the earth. It's got to do with subjugating and mining and processing every living part of the planet. Let's look at ourselves. DNA, descendants and ancestors. DNA, our bone, flesh, and blood. The human part of being, human being. Our bone, flesh, and blood is made up of the metals, the minerals, and liquids of the earth. So we're just different shapes of uranium. We're just different shapes of trees. We're just a different form of hemp. We're just a different form. Because all these things have the DNA of the earth. So we're a part of that life cycle. But we have encountered a period in the history and evolution of the human beings where a mining process is now a part of the life is a part of the life we know on Earth, the mining. And we understand that they take the technologic Western civilization can take all fossil fuels out of the earth and take these fossil fuels and through a refinement process turn them into a form of energy. All right, to help run this technologic mechanical world that we are a part of now. It's like, so then go into the earth and take the fossil fuels, take the spirit of the fossils, and through a refinement process, turn that spirit into a form of energy that they use to oppress the world and run their authoritarian systems. They do it with uranium. They go into uranium, they put it through a refinement process, and they take the spirit of that uranium and turn it into a form of energy. Well, what we need to get in touch with is that they're doing it to us. Human being. The human. The DNA of the human is made up of the metals, the minerals, and liquids of the earth. The being is the spirit of that DNA. Is the spirit. And we have been put into a technologic, religious, civilizing process. That's really, in a way, a refinement process that takes the being part, takes the spirit, the spirit part of human, and converts it into a form of energy, and then this authoritarian, oppressive, genocidal system feeds upon that energy. That's what it uses as the gasoline to run its authoritarian structures. Now, this is the reality of what is around us. So when I look at, but back, and there are many, many struggles that are going on. But I'll tell you, you know, it's like for the hemp, back to the hemp. To use the hemp as the way it is supposed to be used, and that is as a medicine for the earth. Medicine for the earth, medicine for us. The things we should live our lives as medicine for the earth. The earth makes medicine for us. It's that circular way of being. And there's a tremendous amount of political repression, just plain flat old name calling, to try and scare and frighten the people away from understanding the reality of hemp. Now, one more part of this reality, then I'm going to step out of here, but one more part of the reality of the hemp. See, it's about power. See, like how the refinement process works, and it takes the uranium and it turns it into a form of energy that they call power. See, well, those are energy systems. I don't really know if they are power systems. I make a distinction between power and authority and energy. Now, electrical systems, these are energy systems, but we are told that it is power. We are told that it is power. But in reality, these are energy systems. We are told that whoever controls the money and the politics, that these are, that they have the power. But no, they have authority. They have authority. They have authority. And electricity is energy. See, so authority and energy. But we have been conditioned into accepting that authority and energy mean power. And then when we view reality that authority and energy are power, then we will never understand power in relationship to ourselves. We will never understand power in relationships to ourselves because we externalize the definition. No, so about what happens with the hemp, the medicine, whether it's for smoking or whether it's industrial, the authoritarians understand that a generation of people who use hemp in a free, natural, respectful way, that their way of perceiving reality will drastically alter. They will become a less aggressive society. See, and that nails it right there. They will become a less aggressive society. But a part of the mining process, to mine the being part of human, of Western technologic industrial civilization, is it needs aggression. It needs the aggressive, it needs that these fears and all these things that aggression manifest. See, so this is in a way the authoritarians, they fear the power that truly is represented, and whether it's called industrial hemp or whether it's called marijuana. They fear that power, the power that we represent. And that's what this all comes down to. It's not, I mean, it's got something to do with economics and a whole lot of things, but in reality, it's got to do about our perceptions and how we perceive reality. And for us as Native people, you know, I mean, the plain, flat, practical reality to that is that the Native people used, they didn't call it marijuana, Peji. Used Peji. They had a name for it, so I know they used it. You know, but they used it, but it was a part of a way of living a life. See, it wasn't, you know, 1,000 years ago, the Native people didn't say, well, that's Peji, and Nancy Reagan and Ronald Reagan will come along here in another 1,000 years and say, just say no. People didn't relate to that. This whole thing that's going on is a European controlling, a European authoritarian manifestation of fear is exactly what it is. You know, it's a medicine. And like all medicine, what I will say is whether we smoke it or we're using it in the way of the earth, all medicine, it does not matter what the medicine is. If the medicine is abused, then it's not good for you. And that's whether we're smoking marijuana or whether we're not smoking marijuana. That's whether we're taking a contact or a Tylenol or whatever it is. Any medicine that is abused is no longer a healthy medicine. And I think that's something that we as human beings need to kind of put a perception on. But anyway, I'm going to quit.
So in case you're listening on the radio and not here in person, that is John Trudell. He's a Santee from Minnesota, I believe. No? Nebraska? From the Midwest. I'm a California kid with a poor sense of geography. And Akola is a friend, an ally in Lakota. To refresh your memory, we're here at 2000 BC. Today is Thursday, the 18th of December, 97. And one of the things we wanted to talk about was the sovereignty issue. I went back to South Dakota and made a presentation to the Economic Development Authority about the potential of growing hemp on the reservation to make money, and one of the things they were concerned with was sovereignty. Well, can we get away with this? Are we sovereign? And my question is, the casinos are legal. The Native Americans should have right to their own land to do whatever they want, especially something as natural as growing hemp. Unfortunately, you're not sovereign unless you can provide your own housing, your own food, your own education, and everything that goes along with sovereignty. So one of the reasons they're out here is to ask for your help and support also. One of the initial grants that was given to the Running Strong Foundation has been canceled. So Tom didn't say anything when he was speaking, but I'm going to ask him to give his number and name, and his wife, Loretta, we're going to introduce next. This is Loretta Afreda Bear. She's from South Dakota. Were you born in Pine Ridge? And Pine Ridge was recently had the distinction of having the number one death rate, the earliest death rate in the country for Men, 56 years old, by Harvard. And this is an issue that hemp relates to, because this can be nutrition as well as in economics. And one of the reasons people get sick and can't afford health care is economics. So this is Loretta Afraida Bear.
Mitakuye Oyasi. I'd like to include each and every one of you in this presentation made by these wonderful people that's been up here speaking this evening. My relatives back home, for very many years, we were looking forward to something to do in a natural way, and it would appear to me that at this time, the hemp initiative that we have been working with and introducing to our people is probably come to be in its own time, and its time is now. And I think that our people have been moving forward to this time period, working with the gardening and getting to have a relationship back with the earth again. About 2 years ago, my husband Tom and I were asked to come to pray for the environment in New York. And they had passed some material, a glass of water that was crystal clear. You open this water and you smell it, and it gives you a headache, and the headache stays with you. The water was contaminated. The earth was gray and it was dead. There wasn't very much color to it. It looked dead. And I hadn't ever seen anything like that, and I began to ask about what caused this. So then they talked about the food chain, and they talked about human beings as food chain, and they talked about all of these things going on that had caused this. And at that time, the only thing we could do was to pray that the earth start to heal itself. And I said in my prayer at that time, how can we do this? And so when we started to explore this opportunity with the hemp program, on our reservations and talking about as sovereign nations within nations, can we actually do this? My people became afraid. My people became afraid, and the question on their mind was always, what about the law about this? And then I told them, I said, if we don't take this and we don't do something to establish who we are as a people, we'll never differentiate. We'll always be where people want to keep us in that despair. And so then I told him, I said, everything that we do with the federal government, everything that we do with them, it's like fighting the 7th Cavalry all over again. And that's exactly where we're at today in terms of how do we get our people out of despair. And it's only been in working with these gardens that we have gotten our people to actually get their hands in that Earth Mother and to actually call it by its name. It's easy for us to go down to our stepmother Safeway and to pick up what those vegetables are, things that we need to eat. But it's even better if you can grow it on your own ground. And when we're talking about this hemp, my uncles have said that the land and the language are one. And if you lose one or the other, you are no longer people that you claim to be. And these things I have seen in my coming up. At my last birthday, I turned 50 years old. And if I don't do something now, and I ask my people to stand with me to do this hemp program, then maybe all will be lost. That's how critical an issue it is for us. When you look at that economic development, that's a real fancy word out there, meaning survival in my mind. And how can we do that in a way so that our people better understand it? And when we start to pull each other up, and what we've been doing in these last 9 years with the program that you see here, you see all of this beautiful beadwork and all of these things that my people make. People call them arts and craftsy kinds of things. This is the finest art you're going to find from my people. And when we do this as a livelihood, it's impacting a little bit. People are starting to recognize that they can do something natural and pull it from the land and do whatever it is that we have to do. Everybody has a balance. The deer and the elk give their life so that we can eat the meat. And furthermore, we make some beautiful shields out of that. We make buckskin dresses. We make all these things, the traditional art. We have kept that alive. So now we're at a place in time where we're going to take that and we're going to put all these things together and we're going to be able to work the ground and work with something that is environmentally friendly. We're going to work with something this hemp plant that is going to clean the air for us. And we're going to work so that we can wear the clothing from that. It's almost in the line of the buffalo, coming back to that again. And so how you do these things, we're going to, as a people, ask for a support. There are four components to this land use association. And I would like to do it without any asking any money from the federal government. I would like to ask for a support for that. We need funding support for our components. And the first one on our component list is the hemp industrial development. And I think it's a real important thing. I think it's going to set a pace for the rest of the components, the road accesses that we're going to need to get down into those grounds to be able to do these things. And more than that, whatever other kinds of components are going to be inside of this, it's going to need that funding base. So I ask you at this time, maybe you people have some congresspeople that are your brothers and sisters. You can ask them to speak in our behalf and ask them for a support, if you will. Or if you know somebody that's rich and well off and who's willing to stand up for the cause and willing to give something for a hand up, not a handout. The Land Use Association needs your help. Thank you. Oh, our address. Thank you. Our phone number at home is 308-432-2290. And Tom can give you a little bit more information about some other avenues that we could use. Thank you.
Thank you, Loretta. It's really amazing. It's kind of clear here in California especially. We pay more for the water than we do for gasoline. It's $2 a liter for Evian. They have an oxygen bar up the street where if it's a smoggy day and you need a hit of fresh air, you can go up and pay for clean air. So things are falling apart. We need to heal the planet. And you know the gasoline is poison, like John was saying, because you can start your car, go in your garage, running the engine for a half hour, and if the door is closed, in 30 minutes, you'll be dead. Where if we were making our fuels from organic hydrocarbonate resources like hemp, a hempanol, it would release carbon dioxide as a byproduct instead of carbon monoxide, which is food for trees. It was real exciting to see Tom see Jack Hare here earlier. Jack Hare, the author of The Emperor Wears No Clothes, and basically the founder of the modern hemp movement. Tom was all excited. He goes, "Hey, that's Jack. Is that Jack?" And so we're going to ask, this tape is going to not only go to KPFK, but also Keeley Radio, the voice of the Lakota Nation. So we'd like Jack to come up here and say a few words about hemp and help the people there so they know the facts and can make an educated decision and can really stand up to fight for what's right. So here's Jack Hare.
Hearing these guys speak for pot was kind of new for me to hear. You know, they're right. Here it is. Marijuana, the best medicine for glaucoma and chemotherapy and vomiting and multiple sclerosis and on for headaches, for just about anything. It is the only single medicine on the face of the earth, the only single one that you cannot die from. It is made illegal. Millions and millions, 15 million years have been spent in prison in America for marijuana, the one thing on the planet you can't die from. They talked about the industrial uses of cannabis. And I forgot, it really is. Here's the nutritional, the medicinal, the relaxational or recreational or spiritual, and all the comprehensive food, industrial, medicinal, and you could go on forever, and no other plant on earth, not all of them put together, even equal 2 or 3 or 4% of cannabis. And I'll tell you, we should have a world that remembers that speech by John Trudell just now, where he said, it's all of it. He said it in a new way, where he said that the industrial for the earth, the medicinal for the body, the relaxational or spiritual for the mind, all of it is hemp. Where you have nothing to be afraid of anymore. I'm going to tell you for myself, the next 2 years, I'm going to look at the year 2000 in California. I'm going back out to other states to push for 98, probably after January. We worked in Oregon this summer to put it on the ballot because they recriminalized it, and we pulled it off. There's all sorts of weird, strange initiatives going on in Colorado and Maine and other states, and I can't even back them. There's a strange initiative just coming out in California today for marijuana to be legal at 1% THC, which has got to be, the, in my opinion, the worst, stupidest law God ever put on this earth. And I'm embarrassed. If any of you guys are in it, you come up and you give me a reason, you're gonna have a hell of a hard time hanging out with me again. This is a plant that belongs on the earth. It's the end of synthetic plastics, the end of synthetic fuels, the end of poisoning the earth, the beginning of the rebirth, and a slowing down. Like they said, like John said, you guys said, you got to slow down. And the government doesn't want us to slow down. They want us to speed up, consume, consume, consume. It might be just as simple as that, some mass psychology, or is it just some lemming conscious wish to go over the edge? Marijuana saves the earth, saves the place, and gives us a chance to step back on this earth. Put everything back into the natural. The poisons, when they get out of hand, are going to kill 20 million in a day. We're arming troops for anthrax attacks from countries like Iraq, where they can wipe out half the population of the United States in one day with no bombs that we'll ever see. Just a few guys that snuck in over the border with it. You better mellow this planet out. And I'll tell you, I like the idea that the Native American, both white and Indian, can grow their food, real food. We don't have to worry about pests because we got a plant that controls most of them. We got a medicine from it that we can spray on the fields and keep the goddamn pest stone from making procreation. It's a real thing. That's why white worms and boll weevils don't go to cotton fields that were surrounded by hemp for the first 100 years in this country. They didn't have those wars until they stopped using hemp and they went to wire to bale the hay. They used to put a 60, 100-foot fence around 1,000 acres of cotton, and they didn't have any boll weevils. They didn't have any white worms. What they had was this hemp, impenetrable, 2-inch-on plants, fence, and nothing. Nothing could get through that. They would get too stoned to have babies. They were never a threat, and we never had a poison the land. Half of all the poison used on American agriculture today is for cotton, that if we planted hemp, we wouldn't have one drop of. So the only reason they're leading is we're not out there telling them this over and over every day in their face with every fact. They have no excuse except to be bullies, criminals, and when you're putting other people in prison, then I suspect that we need an initiative that we teach all of this information, because people that are putting us in prison in light of this information will need to go to prison if we're going to change the political structure of this country. Bye-bye.
Well, and we have a display on our front window called Guess Who's Not Coming Home for the Holidays, where it lists people and their pictures. One man is in jail for 48 years for growing 5 plants. Others have had their homes seized. It's terrible, the cost. Donald Scott here in Los Angeles was gunned down in his own home. They said, oh, there was marijuana on the premises. None was ever found. But the police were never charged with murder, and really what they wanted was his property, which they ended up getting. What I feel we need to do is not be afraid, because it's only when you're afraid that they can control you. People who aren't afraid can't be controlled. So we need to enlighten ourselves, enlighten our friends, enlighten our families with this knowledge, and then we need to get together and not be afraid, and stand up for what's right. And that's all it takes, because they can't lock everyone up. And the truth is they need this plant as much as the planet needs us, and that's the reason we're here. You know, nothing happens by mistake. There wouldn't be a hemp movement if there wasn't a need for a hemp movement. So I'm really grateful to be a part of it. I met some wonderful people through this. If you're out there listening, get involved and enjoy your life, and do something about the planet. Come support the people here and look at these native crafts, native arts. I don't know if I'm saying the right thing, but it's beautiful stuff that's handmade in a traditional way. And one of the things that this whole hemp thing is about, getting back to the earth and getting back to a traditional way of living, supporting our communities. And one of the ways I was able to start this store was by going out to the hemp rallies. I couldn't make enough money here in my first few months, but we'd have these hemp rallies, and the hemp people would come out and buy my stuff the last day of the month. I'd make my rent. We stay in business. You know, one of the ways I was telling Tom we were able to get ahead was when we stood up for the word bong. They said, you can't say bong. And we said, this is America. You can't say anything, you know. Went to jail, was arrested, had property seized, and we won. We can now say bong. And it was when we got the publicity from that that our customers knew who we were. So sometimes it may look negative, but we can turn those negative experiences into positives for us, because it brings people together. And when you have the attitude like you're not going to lose, you're not going to give up like Gandhi had, we just don't cooperate with the system. We need to get together and not cooperate with locking people up. If you're someone out there listening who's been arrested for marijuana recently, plead not guilty, jam up the courts, support your friends, and let's change the laws. Because whether it's industrial hemp, where people have gone to jail for selling industrial hemp in Alabama, or medical marijuana here in California, where cancer patients are still being arrested, having their property seized, and being persecuted. It reminds me of what the British were doing to the Americans at the time of the American Revolution. We're being taxed without being represented. We're having our property stolen. And we're, in our minds, not committing a crime. You know, most of the people I know who smoke pot don't steal, don't cheat, you know, aren't liars. They're pot smokers. They're not criminals. And we need to stop locking up people who are not criminals. 87% of the people in California in prison are nonviolent drug offenders. We're building more drugs, or we're building more prisons, and the drug problem isn't going away. So do something about it. Stand up and fight where you can, you know, whether it's not fighting but just educating your family, do that. If it's your workplace, without losing your job, do what you can to spread the truth so people realize, like McCarthyism, the drug war is wrong, the government is lying to you. And if you know, one of the things that is the greatest example, smoke a joint and you'll know the government is lying. I'll leave it at that. Do we have all the information for you guys for contacts? And okay. The number, once again, for Tom and Loretta in South Dakota is 308-432-2290. That's 308-432-2290. And if you can lend any assistance, please feel free to give them a call. Thank you very much.
How much hemp are you planning on growing in the spring? And are you going to do things like... creating a small laboratory kind of thing for making energy, or do anything so that
yes.
You're showing different kinds of fabrics that you can make out of it, not just Indian things, but, you know, are you going to be selling that hemp to commercial?
Yes, our goal is to export, to have a net export off the Oglala Lakota Nation. We are projecting to begin with 5 acres in the spring of 98 for a seed production crop, to invest the seed to double the gardens the second year, and then to use the other half to process. Hopefully we can get a seed press and a little building and make some oil and market that. My wife wants to make paper based on stocks that are available in Nebraska, because we're talking about a natural product of the ecosystem of Pine Ridge Reservation and the surrounding region. In the state of Nebraska, there are 500,000 acres of some densities of feral industrial hemp. And we want to use that as a base. We could make paper by going after those stocks as they stand right now. So we're surrounded by insurmountable opportunity, sometimes how we feel. We are getting these together in a three-year plan of development. Our fiscal sponsor is the farm in Summertown, Tennessee, through its organization, Plenty. There's a board member here tonight, Rhino, and the help they've extended, they are extending to the LUA, is a very valuable and essential step, because we're a young cooperative and we now have the fiscal sponsorship of a 501c3 tax exempt organization, so we can get tax exemption to any donations designated for Slim Butte LUA. So we have a three-year plan of our own. When we hit the tribal council level, each representative from the eight districts of this 5,000 square mile territory are going to want to know how we come into the hemp program as a business interest. And particularly, we were well received at the council's Economic and Business Development Committee, where we had three hearings throughout the year and got their vote of sponsorship for our ordinance. The land committee, however, claims precedent, so they want a hearing, and then our legislation gets on to the January session of the tribal council agenda. There is not a large logistical problem like happened in Colorado with the Hemp Production Act, because in the Oglala Lakota Nation, the authority, the voice of the sovereign entity, is the vote of the tribal council in the form of an ordinance. So we only have 16 tribal council representatives. We need a simple majority, so we need to convince 9 or 10 people of the soundness of our organization, capacity, and a challenge to them, to the Oglala Sioux Tribe, to set up a Department of Agriculture, because after all, it is an agricultural reservation. It was created by Congress to be an agricultural reservation. And the Indian Reorganization Act in the mid-30s attempted to pick up where the old policies failed, give the Indians a chance, extend credit, recognize. And so the second phrase, clause in the Indian Reorganization Act was to guarantee to Indians the right to form business associations for economic purposes. Under that clause, they set up cooperatives, land use. Loretta's grandfather and his cousins put together an 8,000-acre piece of rangeland. And all these other areas can be done today, where the tribe can control, tax, regulate hemp production, as distinguishable from anything else, because it's identified there. The problem is, on Pine Ridge, every July, the helicopters from Ellsworth Air Base grid the reservation and destroy any hemp growing anywhere. It always, however, the plant always resurfaces along White Clay Creek, surrounding the Jesuit mission, Holy Rosary, where it was the German Jesuits brought hemp to Pine Ridge in the first place. Another mile north of that mission is the site of Calico, where half a dozen Mexicans married in from the Guantanamo gang from Mexico, from the revolution, and they claim to have brought marijuana to Pine Ridge at the turn of the century. In any case, hemp is a natural product of the Pine Ridge ecosystem. It belongs there. We are just developing the use of the plant and the law around it. The mechanism is up to the attorney. He's presenting the ordinance, but basically it's going to develop tribal code, because tribal code just reflects the federal statute that exempts the mature stocks thereof and seed products. But then confuses the matter by saying the seeds are illegal. So the tribe can differentiate. As an act of the sovereign entity, it's untested, but a very attractive test. Yeah. Does the nation have sovereignty over its own land and its own people, or does it not? It's a challenge, and one recognized as a challenge, because the council members ask a lot of questions about it. And they say, well, why not? We have these other exemptions. For all this time, peyote was illegal on the reservation, except for bona fide purposes and use of the Native American church, the Peyote Society. So, in the same manner, they could make an exemption applicable to its own land and its own people. And nobody knows the outcome of whether the tribe has sovereignty. But this issue, this legislation, will set precedent in the whole development of sovereignty as Indian law. A continuation of activities John Trudell was leading in the late 60s, from the Early House in Virginia through the Trail of Broken Treaties, at Wounded Knee, everywhere since. This is the step of sovereignty. Does the nation have sovereignty? We think it certainly does, because the United States does not make treaties with ethnic minorities, but only with other sovereigns. So that is the state of the affairs. Any other questions? Or thank you very much.
Welcome to Graffiti Land. All the rides are in your head. The ticket is what is thought and what is said. And this together and on our own, a reality of how we feel. Either we can dance with someone or we can dance alone. A plurality of sight and view. We and us are me and you. Ran low, heart speak from the spirit. Say it loud so everyone can hear it. Say what you mean what you say. Rant and roll when you feel that way. Predator views are way too tragic. Mother Earth gives us power. Father Sky makes us magic. Life doesn't have to be bitter, even when it's not always sweet. Synchronicity is the rendezvous when magic and power meet. Rant and roll, heart speak from the spirit. Say it loud so everyone can hear it. Say what you mean what you say. Rant and roll when you feel that way. Rant and roll, rant and roll. Heart speak from the spirit. Heart speak from the spirit.
Heart speak from the spirit. Man roll, say it loud so everyone can hear it. Heart speak from the spirit. Heart speak from the spirit.